Welcome back to the channel. Today we're going to be taking this ugly five-piece ensuite bathroom and transforming it into something beautiful. The homeowners had just purchased this house and they wanted to upgrade the space to make it not hideous. And I know that there's five of you or so watching this going, oh, there's nothing wrong with this bathroom. Why are you redoing it? Well, to you guys, I'm so very sorry that you were born with a smooth brain. I hope you're able to get that looked at some point. But if not, I wish you the best. Now, they had a few other bathrooms in the house with smaller vanities, so they wanted to know if we could salvage this one. So here I'm just using my circular saw to cut through the man-made countertop, and then that way we're able to salvage two smaller vanities from this one larger one that were later relocated. My apologies in advance for the little bit of distortion over the video. For the first couple days of recording, I had a setting mixed up on my camera, so it was fixed eventually, but just bear with me. Before working on the water lines, I shut off the water to the house and then drained the lines in the basement sink, then cut the pipes with a pipe cutter, sanded them down, and put the shark bite end caps on for temporary purposes. Rather than try to drag this beast of a tub through the entire house, I just took the sawzall and ripped it in half. Just much easier that way, getting it into the bin. There was also a nice bed of mortar beneath the tub, which weighed an absolute ton, so I cut it into quarters using the SDS, and it was much more manageable that way. This floor was brutal. There was a very thick underlayment, as you can see, which made it just incredibly heavy. Took me, I don't know how many trips to get it all out of here, but I was exhausted by the end of this. They wanted heated floors in this bathroom, so this is just a 4x4 metal box. Cutting it out and then recessing it into the wall, actually behind the drywall. You'll see why in just a minute. And then notching the bottom plate to make room for the conduits. Because the wires have to go below the tile floor, you need to make sure that your conduits are actually touching the subfloor. It's just going to make it a whole lot easier to get everything where it needs to go. This is half-inch ENT or core line with a half-inch connector on the end of it. The connector just snaps in, it's very straightforward, and the core line can be cut with a knife. You then put it in, put a lock ring on it, which you can tighten up with a screwdriver, and then you can rest assured that those are very snug. In terms of power, because this floor was so large, I ran a dedicated circuit to the panel, and then just clipping it all with some tie wraps and staples. Something I like to do when doing heated floors is notching the ends of the core line. That way you can fish out your wires much more easily because of the sharp bend that they need. And then this is just a plaster ring, which will bring it flush with the drywall. Something else they wanted was a heated towel warmer. It's a really nice feature to have for sure. This one had a built-in switch to it, so I'm just putting in a box with steady power. The draw on this thing was only 1 amp, so I just took it off an existing circuit and then recessed my box. If you're in the US, you can get one of those blue old work boxes and it'll be much easier that way. Reframing the shower wall here. Reason being is one, we're going to put in a niche that's going to be center of this back wall. And two, we're actually going to extend the shower to make it larger. As I'm doing this, I'm constantly checking to make sure everything is plumb, square, and flat, as when installing large format tile, you need these things to be true. Then ripping open the old subfloor. All of this plumbing has to be relocated. The water lines, the drains. So obviously we need access to beneath. Now with the vanity, we're going to have a tower in the right corner there and then a 6-foot vanity double sink in the rest of the space. So some of the plumbing just had to be relocated, which you can see me doing here. When working with water lines, I pretty much always convert them to PEX as it's much easier to work with in my opinion. I sand down the edges of the copper with some sandpaper, take a knife to deburr the inside and then remount the brass fitting. Apply flux to both the fitting and the copper itself, and then solder on my PEX connectors. The drain on the left-hand side there used to drain to the left behind the tub, and now since everything's going to be open, had to fix that and connect it to the drain on the right there. Installing the blocking for the valve in the shower, and then putting in all the fittings with some Teflon to be able to attach PEX to everywhere that I needed it to go. And then running the new PEX. Right now it's going to the tub on the right there. That's going to be a faucet for a freestanding tub. And then the left side, of course, to go to the mixing valve for the shower. I use a 5-inch hole saw to cut open space for the tub and shower drains. They wanted a bench in the shower, and I gave them the choice of a floating bench or a more solid standing bench. They opted for the standing one, so this is just kind of the rough framing for that. And then the niche is just a 12 by 20 Schluter Curti niche. Typically, I would install this after the first wall of tiles, but they're doing something a little different with the tiling in here, so I just installed it beforehand. We're gonna do a giant niche behind the tub. However, I was unsure if this wall was load-bearing or not, and just opted instead to frame out a new wall with a custom niche in it. It didn't take long to frame this out, and you only lose 3.5 inches of space here, so really just not a big deal. drywall in the shower because it's 2022. And I've tried a number of different waterproofing systems at this point, and I gotta say, I'm really just happy with the membrane style system. The only thing I haven't really tried at this point would be the foam boards, but the price tag on those makes me kind of hesitant for it, although I would imagine that the time you save, they might be worth it. The Schluter curbs are just a little too tall in my opinion, so I took a circular saw and ripped an inch and a half off of all of them. These drains come with a 2-inch port, but my existing drains is inch and a half, so I had to reduce it, and then installing the waterproofing. Just wetting down the substrate first to avoid pulling all of the moisture out of the thin set, then taking a V-notch trowel, spreading it all out, and a drywall knife to get rid of any air. When in doing this, it's really important you're not trying to get all of the thinset out of it. That's what's gonna adhere it to the wall. You're just trying to remove any air that is behind that and get that nice tight bond. After finishing the waterproofing it and giving it a full day to set up, I installed this drain plug and put 10 gallons of water in the pan, marking it with a pencil line and letting it sit for another full day. This is of course time consuming, but in my opinion, it's just so worth it for the peace of mind knowing that your shower is in fact watertight. Putting down Dietra heat, before laying it, I like to pre-cut everything just using a knife, it cuts really easy, and then wetting my OSB subfloor, applying the thin set, and tamping it all down with the 1-2 shuffle. This here is a shellac-based sealer for all of the ripped drywall, and then I begin the mudding and taping process. For the heated floor installation, just taking a grout float and applying everything into the insert of the Dietra heat, doing a 2-3 spacing and keeping everything away from walls, cabinetry, heating, plumbing, as per the instructions given by the manufacturer. These are the sensor probes. They go in between a 3 spacing of the cable and then up to the thermostat. You only actually need one of them, but they give you 2, so it's good to have a spare. And then you take your fish tape, pull up the heating cable through one conduit and the sensors through the other conduit. And then that way you're ready to make connections with your thermostat. When it comes to shower floors, I'm always recommending large format tile. Mosaics just get gross over time. There's too many grout lines and it's just a lot of maintenance in my opinion, but of course to each their own. I start by making a template out of ripped down pieces of 2x4 adhered together, and then mark from the corner of the drain to the corner of where the pan will be. Those will be the relief cuts, and don't worry, this floor is being replaced. Now, before installing this tile, we need to polish the edges of those cuts. Because people will be standing on these, we want them to be nice and smooth. So I take a 200 grit polishing pad on the grinder and just give it a couple once overs on each cut line. Then I begin installing the tiles using a 1/16 grout line and a 1/2 inch trowel to install everything. We went with a tileable grate here, which I install just by embedding a bunch of thinset beneath it and then compressing it until it's at the same height as the rest of the tiles. In hindsight, I think a black drain grate would have been much nicer, but it is what it is. For the floor, this is the same tile that will be used on the majority of the walls, which is a 24x24 porcelain glossy tile. I tried to keep the veining, the print there, flowing continuously from one tile to the next, although I had a lot of trouble with this specific tile. I just found the prints didn't really flow into one another too nicely, so while I did my best, it's not perfect, but it still turned out really good in my opinion. This is a pretty standard tile install with the exception of the outside corner there. While it wasn't quoted, I figured I'd try to do some mitered edges as it's just something I've wanted to try and I thought it would look much nicer than tile profiles. And it was easier than I thought it would be. I just took an angle grinder to sliver off a 45 on the edges there, packed them with thinset when installing it, taped them up, and then I got some really nice clean miters that way. When it came to this back wall, due to the height of the room and the size of the tiles, I was going to end up with a sliver cut somewhere. Rather than have that at the top where it would be visible, I chose instead to hide it behind this tub, so I just used a little piece of wood to support the tiles up to the correct height of what the sliver height would end up being. This is a 6-inch wide threshold piece, which will go on top of the curbs of the shower. I pitched them in towards the drain ever so slightly and mitered where they connect just using the grinder there. They decided that they wanted this cool little accent strip in the center of this wall, and it was a lot of fun to install it, just kind of added a little character to the shower, what would otherwise just be plain white walls. So I had these little 1-inch pencil tiles to outline it and transition to the large format ceramic accent tile. This is just a man-made piece of stone here, same as the top of the curbs. You buy them at most tile supplies and just pitched towards the drain. And then doing the niches, the same black trim as on the other wall there, and their fixtures are going to match the same black mat, of course. Cutting out the holes for the potlights before going ahead and priming and painting everything. What I like to do after priming, because it kind of highlights any imperfections, is go around with some spackle and just fill those. Because spackle, you don't have to prime it again. And then after letting all that set up, going ahead and starting to paint everything. To install the cabinet, I first put on the filler strip on the right hand side, which I just brad nail into place. And then once that's in, I push it into place and apply a few screws on both walls where I can get them. You can see here the cuts I had to make in the bottom of the vanity for the plumbing. And then I took some silicone and applied it to the vanity top before lifting this thing like an idiot and getting it into place. Being young really came in handy here. And then the same silicone for the backsplash. They got this giant LED mirror, which I really liked. It had the lights on the back, which instead of lighting up your face a whole lot, they kind of just accent the bathroom in a really elegant way, which I thought just looked really nice. Putting a GFI on the right side and the second wire going to the load side of the plug so that this left plug was protected by the same device. Here I tried coping my inside corners for the first time and it turned out okay. I think with using like a cheap MDF like this one here, you'd only get results that are so nice at the end of the day. Using a real wood, I'm sure I would have had a much better final product. Although, hey, it still turned out pretty good in my opinion, so it's all good. For the potlights, they wanted the gimbal style, meaning it's got that small center, and we set them at 5000K, as I think a white light just looks a lot nicer in a bathroom like this, which is all bright. And then installing the thermostat, pretty simple, just follow the instructions there. We then had a change order, just wasn't enough light in this area here, so we added two more potlights over each of the sinks. I would typically always paint my trim before installing it so that I don't have to spend as much time on it, but there's a little confusion between me and the homeowners on who was doing it, so I ended up doing it after the fact, which no big deal, it worked out in the end. And then installing this giant American standard one-piece toilet, just a lot cleaner than your typical gross toilet. For the bathtub drain, I didn't want to use one of the flexible hose drains as I've heard bad things about them, so instead I opted to just go straight with ABS. I used silicone and Teflon to get a nice adhesion, although if someone has a better way, I'd like to know. And then I cut a hole in the ceiling below to ensure that the drain fit in with one another. Then I did a flood test, and after all that was passed, I went ahead and applied a nice generous amount of silicone to adhere the tub down. And another one done. Well, mostly. Obviously, they still have to replace that window and move in, but other than that, I'm quite happy with how this turned out. If you are in the Toronto area and are in need of a renovation, my contact information will be down below. And other than that, I hope you enjoyed. Have a beautiful day.